Hello everyone. Before we start today's lesson, if you'd like to have a go at Kevin's quiz of the week at the end, find yourself a piece of paper or a book and write the numbers 1 to 15 down the left hand side of the page. Hello Kevin.
Hello.
And how are you today? I know you weren't feeling too great last week, were you?
No, but I'm much better now.
Oh, that's good to hear. So, what's new with you this week?
I've made some new friends.
Some new friends? Oh, okay. Where have you met them?
Well, just behind the shed.
Oh, right, okay. Well, are you going to introduce me to them?
Okay.
Go on then. What are their names?
Wait there. I'll just give them a call.
There once was a ship that was put to sea, and the name of the ship was the Billy O.T. The winds blew hard and the bow dipped down, blow me bully boys blow.
Soon may the wellerman come to bring us sugar and tea and rum. One day when the tonguing is done, we'll take our leave and go.
She had not been 2 weeks from shore when down on her who right well bore. The captain called all hands and swore he'd take that whale in tow.
Soon may the wellerman come to bring us sugar and tea and rum. One day when the tonguing is done, we'll take our leave and go.
He's a musical tow.
Yeah, musical tow.
Yeah, musical tow.
Music vocabulary.
Practicing tempo, dynamics, timbre, and pitch.
Tempo, which is what?
Fast like a cheetah and slow like a tortoise.
That's right, Kevin. We talked about dynamics, which was
loud, quiet, and silent.
That's it. We've also mentioned timbre a lot, which is all about
type of sound or the type of instrument.
Pitch.
What's that? Well, let's meet your new friends, Kevin, and perhaps they could tell us.
Hello, my name's Barry, and I sing in a very low-pitched voice. So during the Wellerman song, I sang the low bass part.
Hello, my name's Dermot, and I have a middle-pitched voice, not too high and not too low. So I sing the middle part of the Wellerman song.
Hello, my name's Sondico, and I've got a very high-pitched voice. So I sing the high parts of the Wellerman
middle
song.
High.
Low.
Two ways you can get to my website. You could either go to Google, type in the box, the word musical toad, and then press return. And then on this list, click on that one. Or by going up to the address box at the top and typing www.musicaltoad.co.uk. And then, on this page, you click down at the bottom where it says click to download PDF poster. And then if you're lucky enough at home to have a printer, you can print one out and put it on your bedroom wall.
Timbre of the week.
Percussion instruments.
This music is all about the planet Mars, and it was composed by a man called Gustav Holst.
Ah, but did you know that Mars was also the Roman god of war?
Oh. That's why it makes me think of soldiers marching into battle.
Do you know what it makes me think of?
What?
That we should actually explain how these drums work.
Good idea. Drums have been around for a long, long time, and they were often used in war. A drum has been found by archaeologists in a place called Moravia in Europe, and it turned out to be 8,000 years old.
Whoa! But drums are pretty simple instruments. They're called percussion instruments. And percussion just means one thing hitting another. Thank you. And so to play a drum, all you need to do is hit it. That is beautiful. Beautiful, Greg. Thanks. As well as the drum, other percussion instruments include the triangle. Thank you. The tambourine. Thank you. And the cymbals.
Are you sure?
Yes.
Okay.
That's pretty loud.
Drums come in all shapes and sizes, but basically each of them is a hollow body which has a skin over the top. And the skin is stretched very, very tight. When you bang a drum, the skin vibrates. The vibration of the drum makes the air particles inside and around the drum vibrate too, and this forms sound waves. The sound waves travel out in all directions, and if they reach your ears, that means you'll hear the sound of the drum.
Right, so we have got this drum here, and let's imagine that this confetti are the tiny particles that make up air, the air molecules, right? And watch what happens when I hit the drum. Thank you.
Whoa, that's good.
That is awesome. That is cool. So when the skin of the drum vibrates, it makes the air molecules, the confetti, also vibrate and bounce into the air.
Oh, I think we're gonna see this much better if we use my super slow-mo camera. Okay, go. So there's the hit. It sets the drum skin vibrating. It chucks that musical confetti into the air just like the air molecules are vibrating above the drum skin. And you can still see the skin vibrating.
It is awesome, it's brilliant.
Looks amazing.
So sound waves are invisible, but another way of imagining how they work is to use this bowl of water and a tuning fork. Tuning forks are used by musicians to make sure that their instruments are playing the right notes. And they work by simply banging them, and then they play a certain note.
Ooh, nice.
This one plays the note E.
Oh, which means that I can tune the E string on my guitar. Go on.
Let's do it. You there?
That's it.
Now, if I bang this tuning fork again, but this time put it into this bowl of water, watch what happens.
Whoa! So let's use our super slow-mo camera and get a closer look. Oh! In super slow-mo, you can see that the tuning fork wobbles. It's those vibrations that make the sound waves. And it's the same vibrations that get the water all excited too.
And it's quite a good way just to spread water everywhere, to be honest with you.
It is, isn't it? Now, you may not realise it, but you actually have one of these inside here. Yes, inside your ear is something called your eardrum. It's like a drum because there is a thin piece of skin-like tissue stretched tight across the opening between your outer ear canal and your middle ear. When the sound waves hit your eardrum, they make it vibrate, just like when Fran hit the skin of her drum earlier. The middle ear and the inner ear convert those vibrations into signals that our brains interpret as sounds.
Now, excuse me. Big drums have a lot of air inside them, and when a drum has a lot of air to vibrate, it makes a low sound. It has what we call a low pitch.
But this little drum has less air inside it, and when you have less air to vibrate, you get a sound with a high pitch.
Nice. But you can also change the sound a drum makes in other ways too. So this drum has a skin which you can make tighter or slacker by turning these handles. So at the moment, the drum sounds like this.
And if we tighten the skin, it sounds like this. Higher. You can even tighten the skin as you're playing it as well to change the pitch. The other thing that's interesting is that the harder you hit the skin, the larger the vibrations and the louder the sound. But the lighter you hit the skin, the smaller the vibrations and the quieter the sound.
And that is what we call
volume! There are lots of different types of drums and drum sounds. You can play just one drum, like a marching drum. That's great. Cheers. Thank you. Or you can put lots of different drums together to make a drum kit. And that is exactly what we're going to do right now in Oh, one, two, three, four! Yes!
Done.
Look at that.
Now, what we've got here is down here, we've got a cardboard box, which is like our bass drum, which we can hit like that.
This is my favourite bit.
It's cool.
Brilliant.
We've got our beautiful cymbal right here. Now these are the drums. And this one's got a little bit of Greg's spare change on top. So that's our snare drum. Nice sound. And to finish off, we have our big bin drum.
Now, actually, there's one more thing we need. An old oil can that I've scrubbed clean. Now I think we are ready to rock!
The largest drum ever made is a South Korean chongo drum. It's 5.5 metres wide. It's 5.5 metres wide, 6 metres tall. Thank you. And weighs 7,000 kilograms. That is heavier than an African elephant.
However, if you want to make drums that are simple and easy to make, fun to play, and cost hardly anything, then we are going to show you how.
What you need is a plastic cup, elastic band, a balloon, and some scissors. Now be careful with the scissors. And what you do is you take the balloon and you simply just snip off the neck of the balloon, like that. Then you just need to place it over your cup, and it's really important to stretch it completely with no lumps and bumps in. Then you take the elastic band and tighten it up. Can you just help me with this, Greg?
Sure.
Can you just put it over?
One, two.
And there you go. That is your drum made. Greg, can you just patch it in that kitchen mallet?
Yes.
Thank you. And you just hit it.
Works well. You can make other types of percussion instruments as well by adding rice, or I've got some popcorn here that hasn't been popped yet. You can just put that inside the bottom of your cup and...
Ah, it makes like maracas. I like that. That's pretty cool, isn't it?
Pretty cool, but I've got to say, I think my homemade drum kit wins this one.
Take it away, Mr. Hulse.
Let's go to Mars.
This is the vibraphone. Compared to most of the rest of our percussion instruments, there's quite a bit of technology. The first is the pedal. And the pedal acts rather like a piano pedal. It sustains the sound of the instrument. If I don't use the pedal, it's rather a dry sound like this. But with the pedal, we can sustain the notes. I can use 2 mallets or 4 mallets. Occasionally composers ask for more, but 2 or 4 is the normal amount. If I use 2, this is just a melodic instrument. And with 4, of course, I can play chords. This is a xylophone, probably the most recognisable of our tuned percussion instruments. The notes are made of wood, and the instrument is nearly always played with hard mallets. You'll hear that in a moment. The lowest note is down here, and the highest one is up here. This is a 4-octave instrument, probably the most common of the ranges. And the notes are arranged like a keyboard, with the accidentals here and the naturals down here. It's most often used as a melodic instrument. And occasionally composers ask us to do a glissando. But one of its chief characteristics is its ability to cut through the most dense of orchestral textures. The glockenspiel, or orchestral bells as it's sometimes known, is traditionally a series of metal notes from small, up here, to large. It can be used very delicately. Or more forcefully. This is a bass drum, traditionally a military instrument and most commonly used in military circles with a pair of cymbals. But it's not only for military purposes it's been used in the 20th century. Sometimes it can sound rather more mellow and quiet. We only ever play on one side of the bass drum. The other head is as a resonating device for this playing head. And sometimes to sustain the sound, we need two mallets. And we can create some quite interesting crescendo effects with them. The tam-tam had its genesis in the Far East, and it's a very simple instrument in many ways. It's a large piece of beaten metal, quite thick. This one's about 34 inches across, and we play it nearly always with a large, soft mallet like this one. And I think what's interesting about the tam-tam sound is the way it develops. It actually grows after you've struck it. And we can capitalize on that by sustaining the sound with repeated strokes quite gently and create really some quite extraordinary crescendo effects. These are snare drums, sometimes called side drums, and they're called side drums because they were traditionally played at the side of the body in military circles. Along with the bass drum and the cymbals, they were used as marching instruments. But today, perhaps, we're more familiar with them as orchestral instruments or as part of a drum kit. We have three different sizes here. This is a tenor drum. That's a quite different instrument. I'll speak about that shortly. Three different sizes producing three different pitches, but all really producing the same effect. We can play with snares off in that way, or with snares on. And the snare on is a different kind of a sound. It adds a different kind of crispness to the sound. Here's the snare off, and here's the snare on. And we can sustain the sound of the snare drum using the sticks, alternating them, bouncing them one to the other. Here's a roll, that's what we call it. Here's a roll with the snares off. And with the snare on. Cymbals have probably the longest history in all our percussion instruments. They're mentioned even in the Bible, in Psalm 150, for example. And they're very familiar to us now as part of an orchestral section. They're very simple. They produce just a single sound. No pitch, no harmony. They can be played like that, rather loudly and with a long note. Or they can be played quite quietly and quite short as well. To do that, I'm going to damp them against my body. But possibly one of the most memorable moments in any symphony orchestra concert will be that sight, not very often, of a cymbal player playing that single, large, loud cymbal crash. The triangle is exactly what it says it is. It's a triangle of metal. It's open at one corner to allow the instrument to vibrate. And we can play it with quite a thick stick, rather like this, or quite a thin stick like this, or even occasionally with a wooden stick. To sustain the sound, we can do a tremolo in the top corner or maybe the side corner of the instrument like this. And I stop the sound simply by holding the instrument like this. Crotales, or antique cymbals as they're sometimes known, made their way to the West in the 19th century in a wave of interest in exotics from the Orient and the Middle East. They're quite heavy to play, they're surprisingly so, they're made of quite thick metal and they produce quite definite notes. We always strike one against the other in that way. I have another pair which is rather lower in pitch. The tambourine is really a hand drum with jingles, and even today in the Middle East, in Egypt for example, they're played like this. There, of course, they're much larger and much more ornate, but they provide the same effect, a rhythmic background to an ensemble. And the present day orchestral tambourine can be very loud indeed, or can be very quiet indeed.
If you've enjoyed learning about the instruments in the orchestra, why not try our iPad app, The Orchestra, featuring Esa-Pekka Salonen and the Philharmonia Orchestra. Fully interactive video playback lets you view the orchestra from all angles, and the revolutionary beat map shows you who is playing when.
Today's song is called Well A Man, and it's an example of our genre of the week, which is sea shanties.
I'm warning you now, there is no chance that you can listen to this next interview without singing sea shanties for the rest of your morning. And you can thank TikTok for that. Here's why.
Once was a ship that put to sea. The name of the ship was the Belly of Tea. The winds blew up her bow, dipped down below my belly boys blow.
That video of Scottish postal worker Nathan Evans just landed him a record deal. When he first posted the 200-year-old shanty on TikTok, well, internet did what the internet does best, and it ran with it.
Soon may the wellerman come to bring us sugar and tea and rum. One day when the tonguing is done, we'll take our leave and go.
Guys, even Kermit the Frog got involved.
One day when the tonguing is done, we'll take our leave and go.
Hi. Today, when we're sailing the boat, we have all kinds of machines and winches and windlasses and other devices that help us sail the boat. 150 years ago, they had a different piece of technology called sea shanties.
I let my gals go a-sailing.
So what is a sea shanty, and how does a song help sail a boat? The word sea shanty itself was not actually used until around 1860, which is the era of the big clippers, these big ships that were sailed with small crews to sail fast back and forth between the United States and China, delivering things like cotton and tea. Because these ships were so big, moving so fast, and they had such small crews, the sea shanty was developed in order to help the crew economize and be more efficient with their labor when working on things around the ship, like hauling halyards, pulling sheets or reefing sail, or even pulling up the anchor. There were three types of shanties sung. These were the long form shanty that was sung for things like raising the halyard. There was the short form shanty that was sung for things like tightening sheets or reefing sail. And then there was what they call the capstan shanty. And this was sung when they were operating the capstan, which was used to weigh or take up the anchor. The most common form of the shanty was a call and response. And the call was led by a person called the shantyman. The shantyman would make the call, and when the sailors responded, that is when they would heave on the lines.
Way, hey, bully in the alley.
A typical example of this is South Australia, which goes something like, in South Australia I was born.
In South Australia I was born.
Is the call, and the response is, heave away, haul away.
Heave away, haul away.
And this is when the sailors would heave on the line.
We're bound to South Australia.
When raising the capstan, what was most important was that the sailors would operate the capstan to the same rhythm. So the call and response wasn't generally used.
Heave away.
I believe that music has a way of reaching us on a deeper, more emotional and spiritual level. The sea shanty is a great example of this.
Don't forget your old shipmates. Olly, 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 ride, oh.
The sea shanties created a community and an environment on board a ship that felt like home for the sailors. What makes the sea shanty valuable today is the same thing it was loved for 150 years ago. It brings people together. While we don't need sea shanties to sail our boat today, it's still nice to turn on a sea shanty, sing the song, and watch the connections and camaraderie develop amongst the new crew. Today, when I hear a sea shanty, I can't help but thinking about the camaraderie and the spirit of adventure that the sailors of old must have felt when singing that song and heaving on a line together, sailing their ship.
Kevin's quiz of the week.
Have you got your answer sheets ready? Pause this if you haven't. Here we go. Question one. What song did I sing today? What genre was it? Was it A, a sea shanty? Was it B, a rock song? Or was it C, a folk song? Question two. Tempo means what? A, fast and slow. B, loud, quiet and silent. Or C, high and low. Question three. Dynamics are A, fast and slow. B, loud, quiet and or C, high and low. Question four. Pitch means A, fast and slow. B, loud, quiet and silent. Or C, high and low. Question five. This is a tricky one because we haven't really talked about it yet, but have a look at the poster. Texture means A, how loud the sound is, B, how many layers of sound, or C, how high or low the sound is. Have a think about it. Six. Percussion means A, loud, B, one thing hitting another, or C, expensive. Question seven. Which of these is not tuned percussion, which means you can't play a tune on it? A, a xylophone. B, a glockenspiel. Or C, a bass drum. Which one can't you play a tune on? Question 8. The sea shanty that Kevin, that's me, sings at the start is called what? A, the snowman. B, the stuntman. Or C, the weatherman. Question 9. Which of these percussion instruments is made of metal? A, a xylophone. B, a snare drum. Or C, a cymbal. Ooh, that's another tricky one. They're hard this week. Question 10.
To play louder dynamics on a percussion instrument, I would A, hit it harder, B, hit it softer, or C, throw it away. Question 11. Sea shanties are usually sung a cappella. This means what? Have a guess if you're not sure. A, loudly, B, without instruments, or C, through the nose. I think that one's a little bit of a silly answer. 12. A bass drum plays low-pitched notes because A, it looks cool, B, more air vibrates because it's bigger, or C, you can hit it harder. Think about those sound waves. 13. What are the bars made from on a xylophone? A, wood, B, metal, or C, cheese? I like cheese. 14. In the documentary about sea shanties, a clipper is what? A haircut, B, an instrument, or C, a type of ship? Last question. Nathan Evans, who has become a TikTok singing star, is from what country? A, United States of America, B, Scotland, or C, England? Answers. Question 1. The song I sang today, the genre was A, sea shanty. Question 2. Tempo means A, fast and slow. Hopefully we're getting really good at that one now. All this practice. Question 3. Dynamics are B, loud, quiet, and silent. Question 4. Pitch means C, high, and low. My friend showed that as well, didn't I? Question 5. Texture. Well, this is really tricky. It means how many layers of sound? B. We'll talk about that more next week. 6. Percussion means B. One thing hitting another, usually with sticks or mallets. Question 7. Which of these is not tuned percussion? So you can't play a tune on it. It's C, the bass drum. Question 8. The sea shanty that I sing is called C, the Wellerman, not the snowman. Question 9. Which of these percussion instruments is made of metal? C, the cymbal. Ooh, I think my post just fell off the wall. Question 10. To play loud dynamics on a percussion instrument, I would A, hit it harder. Boom, boom. Question 11. Sea shanties are usually sung a cappella. This means B, without instruments. That was really tricky. Question 12. A bass drum plays low-pitched notes because B, more air vibrates. Question 13. What are the bars made from on a xylophone? A, wood. Question 14. In the documentary about sea shanties, a clipper is C, a type of ship. And last question. Nathan Evans, who has become a TikTok singing star, is from B, Scotland. How did you do, guys? Remember, you can always have another go if you got any wrong. Perhaps you could watch the video again.
Well, Kevin, this week we practiced tempo, fast and slow. We practiced dynamics, loud, quiet, and silent. We've talked again about timbre, the types of sound or the different instruments, and a new vocabulary that we've looked at today was all about pitch, when it was high, middle, low. That's right, Kevin. Thanks for joining us this week. We've run out of time now, so we will see you all again next time. Bye.
Bye.
He's a musical tone.
Yeah, musical tone.
Right to the stage.
Musical tone.
I said a musical tone.